Nice to meet you, Magda. This is Maria Tsakona from Greater Enda, Norway.
Very nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you as well, under these circumstances and this very interesting panel discussion that we're going to have.
Yeah, so welcome all to this meeting where we talk about plastic pollution in the ocean. So thank you, because this is very important report for me as a freelance journalist. Normally my reports going into Spanish language, but this time I make it this recording, and later I'm going to edit the video and post it in my private YouTube. This mixes many things, but the important is what is in, and then you get the link so they can have a copy. Before I begin this interview and debate, I would like that each one of the guests, both you, in short words, tell us the name, profession, and current position. Please, Maria. Well, there are two Marias. Maria Tsakona, we started.
Okay, nice. So as you mentioned, I am Maria Tsakona. I am here representing Greta Rendal from Norway. I am a senior waste management expert in Greta Rendal, and I have been working in the field of solid waste management sector almost 15 years now. So I think I know a lot of around plastics and plastic waste. Regarding Greta Rendal, I would like to mention a few things about this the organization, which is a non-profit organization. It has been established in 1989 in order to support the environmental sustainable development. And the organization is working along with UNEP and other partners. One of these organizations, let's say partners that Greta Rendal is assisting, is the Ministry of Climate and Environment in Norway. What we are doing in Greta Rendal is that we are communicating environmental knowledge. I would say that we are knowledge providers, and we are doing that by trying to transform environmental data in science-based information programs that will be useful for the organizations that we're working together, and also for decision makers in order to making their decisions on global policies. So this is what we are and who I am.
Thank you very much, Magda Guillermino.
Very nice. Thank you very much for this invitation, Enrique. I am Magda Guillermino. I've been working for many, many years with agricultural family farms, trying to improve their sustainability and valuation. Can I say this? And at the moment, I'm here in São Paulo State. Before, I was working in the northeast of Brazil, and now I'm in São Paulo State. And I still work with agricultural family farms. And also, I have this project called Land or Earth Without Plastic. We say Terra Sem Plástico. It's an educational project trying to inspire people, to be more conscious about their consuming, about their behavior with all their waste. And also I work with building making a collective of people trying to study the encyclical called Laudato Si from the Pope Francisco, from Papa Francisco, who has written this beautiful and important document for our future. And from now on, we really have to understand what is going on Earth. And we need many Marias, many Enriques to improve our life in on Earth. Otherwise, we don't have much time.
Okay, thank you, Magda. Magda is a PhD doctor in graduate in the Reading University in England.
Nice. And Enrique, if I can also take the opportunity to say that recently, I mean, the opportunity of this panel discussion topic about plastic pollution, that recently Greta Rendall has developed a baseline report on plastic waste with very updated data of what is happening currently around the world with plastic and plastic waste, identifying all the emerging issues that we need to take steps and, you know, find solutions for that. And this is a report that has been developed by Greta Rendall on behalf of the Basel Convention of the Plastic Waste Partnership that has been developed. And as Greta Rendall, we have been focused a lot on these issues of plastic and marine litter the last years, and we have established actually a long-standing program of waste and marine litter. And thank you for the invitation.
No.
Thank Maria, may I ask something? Or yes. You are going to ask. I'm very curious about everything you do, Maria. Can you tell me about this report? What conclusion you get? And very good, excellent, Enrique.
Okay, thank you very much. It is known by everyone, we have serious contamination problem with plastic material. Halvard Rovant from Greenpeace, he has informed me that he has problem with internet, so he cannot join with us in this meeting. Maybe if they make some solution, they can come later on. Solveig Haukeland, well, she not promised 100%, but maybe they come in later on also. She's also PhD working in the Kenya University, Nairobi University, sorry, in Kenya. So to continue on this matter, because from starting February, the coronavirus, they increased the problem of plastic pollution. I have read from many colleagues, many journalists around the world, they come at very high pollution. And to use it, the plastic masks and gloves are increasing too much, and they're going to the ocean. So I will be started with Magda. What is the project of which you are leading in Brazil exactly plastic pollution? Tell us, please.
Right. Well, first of all, I have to say that Brazilians, they are ferocious. They are crazed about consuming, you know. So the majority of the population does not have an adequate education. I mean not only formal education, but education at their homes. They are not very aware of ethics and tradition. So capitalism here has been destroying and excluding people and destroying values, because now the most important thing is to have, not to be. So, and this behavior drives population to buy and to buy. Even the poor, they buy. What do I mean? In this COVID, in this pandemic time, everybody is asking for food. Everywhere you go, it's drowned with waste. You know, it has been such a horrible scene. If you go on the streets and you look to the places where they put their waste, most of it are residues. You know, it's unbelievable. So my work here has been to inform people. They should at least to split all this waste into two things. The wet, the basic. You in Norway has been doing this for, I don't know, many, many years. And here we still mix up, you know, the wet waste with the dry waste. So you cannot use, reuse or recycling this residue because it's mixed up with all this waste. So I'm trying to, you know, educate, but not educate, but sensibilize, how do I say, to touch. I'm trying to touch people, to inspire people, to wake up, you know, by themselves. Because I know many PhD people, persons, many professors, lecturers, they also, they mixed up everything. And they don't care about consuming. They consume everything industrialized. So the amount of waste is huge. Even though they think that if they separate the wet waste and the dry one, they are doing a very good thing. They don't understand that they have to stop buying, stop consuming. So this is my job at the moment. And also based on Laudato Si. I don't know if you heard of it, but you must read it. I don't know if Maria knows. Have you heard of it? This is not for Catholics. This is not for, you know, it's for people of goodwill. If you have a goodwill, you have to read Laudato Si.
Thank you very much, Marta. I want to ask Maria, how are you talking the problem of the environment in relation to the plastic pollution in general? I mean, in the river and the ocean, mm-hmm. or in the sea?
Mm-hmm. First of all, let me highlight something that Magda has put out when it comes to plastics. Plastics are cheap, actually, and inexpensive. That's why they flourish our life, and because they're inexpensive, a lot of people, especially poor people, you know, are going for plastic products. That's one thing. The other thing that is the consumption patterns. They consume, and the consumption patterns, we don't really understand nowadays what is around the consumption patterns in order, you know, to effectively try to deal with that. That are two points that Magda has put out. And in general, I would like to say that, you know, plastics are not necessarily bad. You know, we need to admit that they have flourished our lives with products, that they have, you know, valuable uses. Imagine that we wouldn't have advanced in medicine, let's say, and we didn't have plastic in our lives to provide life-saving devices. And we wouldn't even be able to make space travel possible. However, as Magda has pointed out, it doesn't come without challenges. That's why now we are dealing with such a major problem, such as plastic pollution. So plastic pollution, I would say, is the result of a very increasing growth of plastic production of these inexpensive and durable products being affordable to many since the 50s. And the problem here lies on the fact that we have also seen that last decades, almost half of these products are plastic products of very short life, such as packaging. That means that find their way into the environment very shortly. Some products, like let's say plastic cups, they can, you know, being disposed in the environment in just 10-15 minutes. And this has led to a significant also plastic waste generation. And the problem here, and this is why we deal now with plastic pollution, is that this plastic production was so rapid that has outpaced our ability to manage this plastic waste effectively. And I would like to also provide some numbers here to understand, I mean, the problem. Since the 50s, we have estimated that almost 6.5 billion of plastics have been produced worldwide. And the amazing thing is that we have also estimated that only 10% of this plastic has been recycled and another 12% has been incinerated. We have seen that a small portion is still in use, and 60% of this is in an environment.
Sorry to interrupt you.
Yes.
I have taken reference of the report of the Minister of the Environment here in Norway, mm-hmm. and they said it's estimated that 8 million tons of plastic end up at the ocean each year. This corresponds to 15 tons of plastic per minute. That's incredible.
Yes, it is. This, right. Actually, it was first Dr. Jane Jambeck in 2015 that she has reported that almost 9 million tons of plastic waste enters the ocean from coastal communities each year. And we have also a recent report from World Bank that states that 150 million of plastics are found in the oceans. So these are pretty huge numbers, and these percentages that I put to you and your audience, this 10% only recycling, it's also providing evidence of our inability to handle plastic waste, to manage plastic waste properly. And the result is that we find a lot of plastic into the environment, accumulating much of this in dump sites, especially in developing countries, we found that. And we found plastics in the vegetation where they degrade, and then we get small particles, you know, microplastics, and plastics either in the form of macroplastics or microplastics, they are transferred through different pathways. We all know rivers, let's say this is one pathway, and they finally find their way in the marine environment. And this is not the last thing, because the last thing is the wildlife and humans. And then there we come with adverse impacts with our economy, especially for the coastal areas. The tourists, their economy has been impacted in many areas. And we come with impacts in the wildlife, especially the marine animals that can be harmed. And this can be made either by mechanical effects, such as, let's say, entanglement in plastic objects and problems that are related to injection of plastic waste, or through the exposure of the chemicals that leak out from the plastics and interfere with their physiology. And when it comes to humans, we have suspicions, and there is some research about the impacts. We don't hold a lot of information, but there are some research says that the effects on humans of the plastics include disruption of various hormonal mechanisms. And to stop here, but to say that plastic is almost everywhere. They have even found plastic in very remote areas, such in Arctic. They have found plastic particles even in samples, rain samples, and they even find plastic particles in our draft beers. So plastic is everywhere, and I would, from my point of view, plastic pollution is another reminder, along with climate change, of the serious global impacts that are generated by millions of local inappropriate actions and inactions. And in this respect, plastic pollution provides an opportunity to demonstrate and make it easily understood the urgent need for a shift in our society, a shift to a more sustainable living.
Yeah, well, both of you, they have get Maria got the mail from Janet, but this is article from the newspaper El Tiempo from Colombia. Mm-hmm. Sorry, that was in Spanish, but you can translate by Google. That was last week, the article. This problem with the plastic solutions, they are increased with the mask and glove, the way I tell before, and this problem, the coronavirus. And they are found in the ocean, tons of this, and then I'm going to ask in Magda, how we can store the plastic pollution in the ocean? Well, also for Maria later, the same question.
Well, thank you. I strongly believe that we must invest a lot of our resources in education, because people, they don't understand. We are inland in the interior. We are far away from the ocean. For example, we are about 400 kilometers from the ocean here in Ribeirão Preto. And they don't understand if they threw away a plastic bag on the street, it's going to go to the ocean. They don't understand that everything that goes to the roads go into the gallery, water gallery, and it will be ending at the ocean. So they understand, the people understand that the problem in the ocean is just for people who are by the sea. If you are on the shore, okay, I understand I cannot throw away bin or plastic bags or cigarettes. But if you are here, they don't care. They can throw away. You know, they can throw away cigarettes, plastic bags on the streets. So people, they are not aware yet of their responsibility. We have many, many research everywhere about microplastic, about contamination, fishes, animals, as Maria said very well. You know, they have identified all this microplastic everywhere in every creature in the world. But if we don't work with people, if you don't make strong laws, if you don't put laws in the industry, I would like to talk about circular economy. That's not enough, but industry has to take care about their waste. They have to be responsible also for everything they produce. And I, in my point of view, we have to work with people. We have to educate people. This is the only way to decrease plastic contamination. And as Maria said, plastic, it has its value. We are not saying that it must disappear. Of course not. It is very important. Achievement of humans. It can help in the hospitals for this pandemic and every many, many good ways of using plastic. But we are over. Here, for instance, very huge problem is something called EPS. We say isopor. Do you know, Maria? What's that?
Could you explain EPS? To us? EPS?
It's called isopor. I show you. So
not EPR.
Everywhere...
You don't mean EPR.
EPR? It's a sort of plastic.
Environmental producer's responsibility.
Very light. Very light.
Oh, okay.
We say EPS, but I don't know. Isopor is called. It's something good for put the bacalhau to be exported. Everything cold you put inside this material, this packing material, you know, what is it? And let me show you this.
Yeah, that's one of the worst, let's say, materials, and the one that is found mainly in the environment, polystyrene. Yeah.
Exactly. This is the worst. Well, it's horrible. Everywhere here, everywhere you find this food packing made by this. You know, it's finishing, getting to the ocean.
Cleanup activities, you find these materials. Yeah.
Exactly. But, you know, it's going to get to the ocean. It's going to get to the North Pole. It's going to get to the, you know, animals and fishes. They don't need to buy food in this. Why to buy and why they offer this? In fact, they don't know what they are doing. I'm like Jesus now. Forgive them. They don't know what they are doing, but it's enough of forgiveness. It's time to change their mind. There is just one way, education. Not formal one, but touching them somehow. I don't know. This is it, Enrique. Your sound.
Yeah, Maria, yeah, your opinion.
Okay, yeah, so Magda has just put very nicely the fact that if we would like to stop plastic pollution, we need to involve people who are the ones that are actually producing plastic waste and educate people. This is one thing, and the other plays their responsibility to producers of plastic products. But let me put it in another perspective, let's say. We have been working with Guidarenda, as I said, around the plastic pollution problem. So what we have seen here is that in order to fight plastic pollution, you need to define which are the main causes, what caused the plastic pollution. So we have seen that the plastic pollution is associated with four key systemic failures, which are directly related to waste and resource management. Which are these four systemic failures? The first one is related to the fact that we face poor, or in some places we face lack of solid waste management services and infrastructure. And this, we see that mostly in developing countries. There are countries that they have not even in place collection systems. And there are countries also that they have insufficient monitoring system for waste management, or they have very low law enforcement. This is one of the main systemic failures that leads to plastic pollution. So since we cannot somehow manage plastic waste on land before they escape into the environment, this is one problem that we need to find a solution to. The other systemic failure has to do with the fact that we're facing a very problematic and vulnerable market for secondary plastics. We have been talking a lot of recovery plastic and recycled plastic, but if the industry cannot uptake secondary plastics, and if it is not viable for them to work with secondary plastics, this increases the problem of pushing the efforts of more recovery of plastics. The third systemic failure has to do with our in-depth understanding of technical challenges. Plastic materials are not that easily to recycle or to the end of their lives. We know all of us know some seven types, basic types of plastics, but these are not coming alone. Plastics, they're filled there with additives in order to be more durable or more flexible. So this, we come up with thousands of plastic products in the market, which needs different technologies sometimes to, you know, to treat them. And in many cases, not all plastic products could be viable for the plastic industry, you know, to treat. It's you know, we have seen that the industry is more favorable to recycle PET or HDPE products, because are more easily to handle. It's very difficult to handle mixed plastic. It's very difficult to mix contaminated plastics. As Magda mentioned, we have the wet and the dry material. And most of the time, we see that wet and dry materials are all together mixed. And this is a very dirty material for the industry to treat. And the last, I would say, failure has to do, as Magda mentioned, with social consumption patterns. We are not very aware of these social consumption patterns. We are not aware how people litter. UK is facing a major problem with littering. Most of the plastic pollution in the UK comes from littering, also in other countries around the world. And we lack the knowledge of how people litter and why they litter and how we can stop that. And it needs a lot of our awareness there around that and a lot of education, as Magda pointed out. And in fact, in many areas around the world, there have been efforts to reduce and to stop plastic pollution. We have seen programs trying to reduce plastic consumption partners. We have seen programs enhancing better source separation of plastic so that we can come up with cleaner plastics and increase recycling. There have been efforts, a lot of cleanup activities, and recently there's a lot of discussion around redesigning products, which could be a solution to stop plastic pollution, redesigning plastic products in order to increase recyclability, in order to change the characteristics and find them less in the environment. So in general, we cannot say that there is just one solution to stop plastic pollution. There is a combination, I'd say, of solutions that at the end, they need global efforts, and not only locally. You need local efforts, but at the end, mm-hmm. you need some global coordination here.
Yeah, I have here some...
Enrique, I want to say to Maria, thank you very much. Your approach is excellent. I also believe it is not one solution, but lots of efforts from everywhere. And if it's possible, I would love to have your report, because you have pointed all the steps and everything that makes it appropriate. Very good, Maria.
I will share the link with you. I can share the link with you. You're more than welcome. It's a nice work that we have put together with Krida Rendell there. I think very valuable for people that they are working in the field, and also for the policymakers, to take next steps to deal with the problem. And I would also, Enrique, because you are mentioning a lot about this last issue, the recent issue with the pandemic, and a lot of masks and gloves find their way in the environment. It seems that in such situations of emergency, if you have a good, a very well-established waste management system in place, this is what is happening, actually. You get a lot of these materials into the environment. Combining with the fact that we need to raise the awareness of people of how to better and inform them of how to better deal with this type of special, let's say, infectious waste. As gloves and masks in the pandemic, they are not just plastic waste, they are infectious waste, and we have to deal with them accordingly. And we have recently developed guidelines for citizens and for waste operators of how to better deal with household waste in areas of, let's say, a pandemic.
Continuing with this interview, debate, I told you I get some reference from the government. One of the documents has sent them to all journalists, the Norwegian Development Program to combat marine and litter and microplastic. And I want to say this, the government of Norway, we has spent 1.6 billion Norwegian crowns, that's around $200 million US dollars. on the development program to combat marine litter and microplastic in the period 2019 and 2022. Relation with this, I want to ask in both of you, is there any key cooperation in a project related to the plastic between Norway and Brazil? And start with Magda.
I don't know. My answer is I don't know, because we have this difficult government at the moment, and I heard they have a difficult relation with Norway and the program with Amazon, and I'm not sure how they are dealing, you know, with this cooperation anymore. I was trying to find something in the internet, but I couldn't. I found something, but old, but not not now. So I can see that they support some research in microplastic in the labs, but very specific research. I could see this. And I saw here they have 5 international joint projects on research on microplastics in the ocean. It's 19 from 19. I don't know how they are now. I can see they have these 5 joint projects, but I cannot tell you how it's going on at the moment.
Maria, Maria, do you have any contacts in Brazil?
As Maria knows, as Greta Renda, we are aware that Norway, through NORAD, is funding various activities to reduce and stop marine litter. And some of these activities are in Brazil. Of course, I cannot speak on behalf of the government of Norway because we are not part of the government. I'm not aware of these 5 projects that the Magda mentioned. I am only aware of one program that is under this Norwegian development program that you mentioned. And this is a project that is entitled Building Knowledge to Combat Marine Litter. It has initiated in 2019. It's between Norway and Sao Paulo, Brazil. And the scope of the program is to establish a long-term strategy to monitoring and assess marine litter in the state of Sao Paulo, and also to improve the engagement of different stakeholders. This is what I know so far. Also, I mean, if you're interested, this is realized through the Brazilian Biodiversity Fund, with the technical expertise of the Oceanographic Institute of the University of Sao Paulo and the participation of UNESCO Chair on the Ocean Sustainability. And the funding that has been allocated is about 1.3 million Norwegian kroner, which is, it depends from the fluctuation of the euro. It's 130,000 euros, something like that, around that. I suppose that if they are not very much affected by the pandemic, that they will come up with first outcomes and results by the end of August this year. But I have no more details to share with you about the program.
Very nice, Maria. It's good to know. I'm going to try to find these people there in the São Paulo state. It's not just fine, but I was in the Northeast. I'm not still, I don't know what is going on here. I'm just, you know, the beginning of my time here. But very nice.
Nice to let you know that. I'm very happy.
Magda, talking about your project, where some you are leading in Brazil, do you receive support? Any economic support from the government to do this project?
Sorry, Enrique, what did you say?
You receive your project. You are leading in Brazil. Is there any economic support from the government?
No, not yet. We are, in fact, I start this project just as a volunteering.
Yeah. You
know. Now it's getting bigger and bigger, and I don't know, maybe I will find some more partners, I'll make it more professional, and I don't know, maybe Maria can help us, I don't know. And yeah, not yet.
Maria, you mentioned, as you know, working with the Norwegian government, but in another hand, this kind of project, for example, I get information, this is, was in February, they have a new working together India and Norway, and to explore a global agreement to stop plastic pollution. This is a project from India and Norway, also between. You working also with the government in another hand, or in or Sanarbeid, I forgot what that's in English. Duforstonorsen, Sanarbeid is work together with the Norwegian government.
We are working together with the Ministry of Climate and Environment, yes, and we are working in different projects related to marine and plastic litter. In general, Norway is playing a prominent role in setting the global agenda for global policy against marine and plastic litter. And they are funding not only organizations such as Greater Rendel, you know, to come up with solutions, research, but they are also funding different incentives. For instance, Norway is working under the UNEA resolution on plastic and marine litter. That focus on global coordination and cooperation to eliminate plastic and microplastics into the ocean. And as you mentioned, Norway has recently launched in 2018 a new development program to combat marine litter and the microplastics. You mentioned the budget, and you mentioned the period. And I want to say that under this funding, there are a lot of recipients, you know, working together. There are different organizations such as UN, the World Bank, NGOs, and the research institutes. A lot of them, they're working with governments in different countries, working with the private sector and the local pollution to provide solutions in this field. And Norway supports all these efforts, and they're very much interested in such projects. I mean, for instance, they are very much contributing to creation and development of land-based waste management systems. So we have sound waste management. As you mentioned, there is this problem with India and Norway. And Norway is focusing a lot on Asian countries where you have most of the problem of marine litter and most of this of the escapes, more than 50% of plastics, you know, going into the ocean comes from Asia. And then they are also focuses in countries such as in Africa and in small development, developing island states. But they are very much interested in many different projects, and they invest in research, and they have, for instance, supporting projects for developing tools to identify plastic pollution hotspots, or developing mapping tools and increasing knowledge on ocean currents and so on. And lastly, they introduce funding in increasing awareness programs and they have supported a number of cleanup activities, as far as I know. So Norway, you know, it's leading the way on the global agenda, and they're and very much interest, and therefore they are allocating substantial funding, you know, to deal with this major problem.
Thank you very much. Before we finish, you have a free to make a question to Magda. Magda has free to make a one question to Maria. So Maria can start to make a one question to, well, I don't know, is they are free to make a question.
May I start with?
Okay.
Maria, I'm very interested in your work.
Yes, please.
Yeah, excellent. This I want to know, I can find it in internet, right? It's called Grid Arendal, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes, Grid Arendal.
Right. So, and I'm going to study this page. And I would like to know, for instance, for us here in Brazil, to work with you, for example, with the Grida, how do I do? Do I need to be at university or in an organization? Or can I start with a civil volunteer, for example?
Uh-huh. I think I'm not the best person from Grid Arendal to answer this question, because I'm working most in the field, and you know, I'm taking the projects and I'm realizing the project. But I will be very happy to put you in contact with people from Grid Arendal, that they know how partnership could work between Grid Arendal and other organizations. I mean, traditionally, Grid Arendal is working with UNEP, and with the Minister of Climate and Environment, but it also involved in other projects. So I want to be at the safe side, and I will recommend that, you know, after we hang up of this, let's say, call to contact and, you know, direct you to the person who is the right person for that.
Right, thank you. Maria, another thing, you said you work in the field.
I'm an engineer. I'm a waste management engineer. I have been working in landfill sites, let's say.
Norway.
I am not only in Norway, in other places as well around the world. And I am of these persons that I love to be in a waste management unit, you know, going around asking questions about waste. And you probably find me also in a bar talking with my colleagues about, around waste. That's so weird, you know.
Okay, Maria, you can make a question to Magda if you like it.
Yeah, I'm not prepared, but I was thinking, you know, one thing that troubles me lately is what is happening around the world with plastic recycling due to the pandemic. I have noticed that in some countries, that like in US, recycling wasn't working during the pandemic, and a lot of the plastic recycling units, you know, not operated and so on. And I just wanted to ask you, Magda, if you're aware what has happened with plastic recycling in Brazil. And I know in Brazil you also have a lot of the people working in the informal sector. So I wanted also to ask how this pandemic has influenced these people in the informal sector. So two questions, actually.
Right. Excellent questions, Maria. Thank you so much. Well, here I work with a social project for recycling. They are collecting, they are, as you said, people in the street. They are very poor people who collect all this plastic in the streets. And they get all of this and they go to this place where they try
select.
To... Yeah, they select and discharacterize. How do I say? They make it the form. Sorry?
You mean sort out the waste?
They sort out and they let's say for this flask here, for instance, mm-hmm. for this one, they press them and melt and become again Estireno to go to the industry, right? Mm-hmm. So here they didn't stop. Most of them they didn't stop. The problem is when they have this disposal from hospitals and in the streets with masks, as you said, and all of this, where to put them? You know, these poor people, they get all of this. And most of them, maybe they have coronavirus, I don't know, but they are strong.
Magda, do they use any protective equipment? Like, do they use masks from textile or something?
Nothing. Some people, they put some water and soap on the streets for them to wash their hands, but they are not used to that. They don't have even a shower, you know, shower maybe once a week. I don't know. So I'm very worried, in fact, because they didn't stop, but maybe they should, but they didn't, because if they don't collect, they don't eat. Even though we are offering them food and everything, but every single day, how do they manage? They are on the streets, you know. And also the government here is not that bad. They offer them a place to stay, but they are not used to stay inside. It's weird. It's like they like to be on the streets, you know. They feel, I don't know, they are used to be in the streets. They collect all this littering from house to house, and they don't know if it's infected or not. You know,
Magda, another questions, you know, coming after what you have mentioned. What do you think is the best way to protect these people during such crisis or pandemics? Is there a way to protect them?
Good question. They should stop collecting. They should stop collecting, because we don't know if this littering is contaminated or not. You know, we don't know. But how they can stop collecting it, and how the streets are going to be? Because to be honest, even the official collectors, let's say from this municipality, they don't collect properly, because not everywhere, you know, not always. So it's going to be really a mess. I don't know, did I explain correctly, Maria?
Yes, correctly. And I think this is a main issue, not only in Brazil, it's also around the world when it comes to the informal sector, that in such periods they don't want to lose you know, not jobs, I mean they're making the living through this recycling process. And from our part, we're trying the best, you know, to protect them. One thing that we have been doing as Green the Rental is providing guidelines, let's say, not to directly to the informal sector, but the people of waste management authorities or the government, that could use these guidelines to inform informal sectors of how they need to act in such situations in a pandemic period.
Then also, just to say, most of them, they don't believe it. They don't believe in the virus on top.
Yeah. To complement the why the Magda said, I think the big problem is because we have a different culture. We cannot compare Norway or Europe culture with the South America or North America culture or Asia culture. It's a complete difference. And the education how to recycle is very difficult if it, in each country, at least in South America, the governments have high level corruption. That is the most big problem. I've been in Philippines, and the waste, all the plastics, cartons, metals in the street, into the ocean. the people going to resort and enjoying life, the vacation, and doesn't care, it's just in the beach, cast waste the plastic, no. It's nothing compared like in here in Norway, that when you buy products in plastic, you need to pay extra 1.5 crowns. And when you make it empty, you need to back to the shop to get this money back. This is education. This is something they need to copy Brazil, Colombia, all the countries in South America, or they had a different culture, you know? So
let me just say something, Enrique. But yeah, also the rich countries, they send their littering to us.
Yes,
they put in this big, they're not that good. Nobody is. The human being is horrible. Some are very, very good, and some are horrible because they are still working with money. You know, we have plenty of rubbish coming from everywhere in the world, by plane or by ferry or boat.
Magda, you are setting the ground for another big topic, which has to do with transboundary movement of plastic waste. But this is another discussion, you know, to go another time.
yeah, of course. Well, I will say thank you very much for this interview, for this meeting, for this debate. I had a lot of job for writing in Spanish.
Thank you, Enrique. Thank you to introduce me, Maria. Very nice.
You get the mail. You get the mail from Maria. Maria get the mail from Magda. Send the same my link, so they can copy and then be in touch for the future. I hope Norway enjoying or working together with Brazil in this kind of project, because it's very important to solution, because now with this pandemic, they increase much this plastic pollution into the ocean. So we need to look in so far stop this, even to finish at this meeting. I have written here that analysis that before the pandemic, each year nearly 12 million tons of plastic was wasting reached the sea and the ocean around the world, the equivalent of 1,200 times Eiffel Tower. I mean, it's incredible. So thank you very much. Have a nice weekend.
Thank you, Enrique. Nice to meet you, Maria.
Thank you. Thank you for this fruitful discussion. Magda, thank you so much. Nice meeting you. We will keep in contact. Thank you. Have a nice afternoon from my place. Bye.
Ciao.